How many times have you cried out for help? You feel like you're at the end of your rope, you can't cope any longer. Well, God's Word shows us how we can be more than conquerors as we get into it. Because we know if we turn loose, we're just going to fall in this bottomless, hopeless pit of despair. So let's get into the Word of God. Take a look at what Jesus declares in John 16:33 when he says, "In this world you're going to have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world." Now, it's good to know that, but how do we move it from the head to the heart? And that's what we want to do during our time together, is to move this whole concept to our heart. So that not only will you find yourself coping, but you're going to be experiencing hope. You're going to be experiencing power. You're going to discover what it is to be more than conquered through Christ who strengthens us. What does he say about hope and this hope that Christ provides that we can overcome the world? Well, let's take a look at Romans chapter 5 and 8. It says, "Hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given. God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." We're looking at a hope that does not disappoint. So there you are, hanging by the rope. You wonder, you're just barely hanging on. You're at the end of that rope. You don't know how you can cope any longer. We've got to discover this hope that does not disappoint us. We have to begin to discover the love of God that passes all understanding. We have to let his power flow in us and through us and know that God has everything all in control. You didn't worry about the sun coming up this morning, did you? No, it happened. You didn't worry about all these things that God just allows to unfold around you. So why do we have to continue to live in worry and hopelessness and despair when instead we can get into God's Word and know that as Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrated his love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The love of God begins to pass all understanding. We won't feel like we're at the end of our rope, but we're just letting his love, his power, his presence flow in us and through us at this particular moment. And the reason you can do this is because you've been uniquely and wonderfully made. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it says, "You are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus, do good works which God has prepared in advance for you to do." Now, to help you do more than just feel like you're hanging on by the end of your rope, let's take a look at four P's. The first one is purpose. God has a purpose for your life at this particular moment. Even in the midst of COVID-19, there is a purpose for your life. In fact, he laid out a purpose for all of us in Matthew chapter 25, starting at verse 35, when he said, "For when I was hungry, did you give me something to eat? When I was naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, you visit me? A stranger, did you welcome me? As oft as you've done to the least," as he said, "even so you've done it unto me." All around us, this purpose is becoming more and more critical. So many people losing their jobs during COVID-19. So many people experiencing hopelessness. So many people despairing. As I head to the streets, I've never seen so many people that needed water so bad. A simple thing like water that we take for granted in this country because there aren't water fountains around. And they close them off. They can't go into public buildings and just get water like they did in the past. They can't go into fast food restaurants because they're not even going in. They're just doing drive-through. There's so much need just for water and food among so many people that are right around us. There is a purpose for each one of our lives. You know, Satan can't take that purpose away. He tried to do that when he closed down our church at 1411 Locust. And the Lord of God spoke to my heart to take these messages, print them up, and take them around to the hurting and the homeless, giving them food and water as I gave them the Word of God. And now I'm preaching to more people than ever before. There's a purpose for you out there. So let's get into the purpose God has for us. And instead of panicking, let's pray. That's the second thing. First thing is to the purpose. The second thing is to pray. I want to encourage you to begin to pray right now. And as you pray, just allow the love of God to flow over you like the waves of the ocean do. Let him just flow over you. Let him tell you, "I am with you always, even to the end of the world." Let us hear what he's trying to say to us. For example, when we take a look at Philippians 4, where he says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but everything, every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." Okay? So by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And there's a promise that goes along with that, his peace that passes all understanding. So there you are. First, discover you got a purpose. Second, begin to pray. And third, prioritize your time. Pace yourself. The third thing is to pace yourself. Pace yourself. It's so easy for us to feel so overwhelmed. So to the tyranny of the moment to drive us here, drive us there, drive us here, drive us there, and never really get anything done. We need to pace ourselves. And the older we get, the more and more important it is that you and I begin to pace ourselves and know that, yes, the Lord has everything under control. So what happens, those things, your memory slips, you don't remember something? Depend on the power of the Holy Spirit more, who bring all things to remembrance. You're not able to move as fast as you used to in the past? Depend upon God, who'll give you strength in due season. Pace yourself is what he tells us, and we see this in God's Word. And Proverbs 4:26 says, give careful thought to the past for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. And then, again, move forth in the peace of the Lord. That's the fourth thing. So did you get that? The first one is shooting to purpose. The second one is to pray. Third one is to pace yourself. And the fourth, experience the peace of God. Now, Jesus tells us in Matthew 11:28-30, come to me, all you who weary and laden and hardened, and I will give you rest. Take your yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble at heart, and you'll find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus is gentle and humble in heart. He loves you. He wants the very best for you. And he's promised that he will never leave you nor forsake you. And oh, the peace that awaits us in the midst of this coronavirus at this particular time, if we'll learn to trust in God. In Romans chapter 8:37-39, we're told, in all these things, we're more than conquerors. We're not just survivors. We're not just making it. We are more than conquerors, we're told, to him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The love that God has for you is the very foundation at this particular moment that's going to enable you to allow his peace that passes all understanding to sweep over you. The very thing that's going to wash away the fear, the worry, the unbelief, as you begin to realize that that foundation of God's love is there to sustain you, to strengthen you. The question is, are you going to receive this love? Satan's constantly walking around like a roaring lion seeking me to devour. He's constantly wanting you to take after this illusion, so to speak, and deny the real love of God. When Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And you know, when I'm at the end of the rope, it's so easy for me to just feel like, wow, I've blown it and I can't go on. But you know, I've got to remember what God is trying to tell me in Romans 8:1. That there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So stop condemning yourself at this particular moment. Stop condemning yourself that you're not further up on the rope, so to speak. Stop condemning yourself for this, that, or the other. Instead, just relax in the peace of God that passes all understanding. And if you're going to turn loose where you fall into his love, his power, his presence. Don't turn loose in the midst of depression, discouragement, hopelessness. Know that he will never leave you nor forsake you. So we want to get in there, deep in the words of God. And when Satan tries to stress you out, tell you there's no hope, you say, devil, you're a liar. I'm going to trust my Lord Jesus Christ. I know that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm going to ask him to come and fill me, and I'm going to maintain my confidence in the living God. When we turn to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35 and 36, we see that. It says, don't throw away your confidence. It'll be richly rewarded. You need to persevere, so when you've done the will of God, you receive what he has promised. Don't throw away your confidence. Lift up your eyes and begin to see all the beauty and wonders of God's glorious creation. Open your eyes. Why do you think David was so strong in the Lord? You know, he didn't have all the scriptures to go to that you and I do, but he had the wonders of God's creation. God's works are all around him, and he meditated on the work of the Lord. And he let that meditation on the work of the Lord deliver him from and free him from worry and fear and stress. He had quite a job he had to do. Wow, to take a bunch of disjointed tribes and turn them into a mighty nation. But it happened through the living God. And by David continued to trust God day after day after day. So I want to encourage you right now. Get up, go outside, look around, look at the sky, look at the trees, look at the beauty of creation. Lift up your eyes unto the Lord. And let him strengthen you at this particular moment. You don't have to just dangle there, feeling that you can no longer cope because you're at the end of your rope. Lift up your eyes unto the Lord. From whence cometh your help? and let His peace and power and hope flow into you, and watch Him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Lift up your eyes and look at all that God has created, and accept the fact that He loves you. Accept the fact that you've been uniquely and wonderfully made in the image of God. Receive it. Receive His love at this particular moment on a daily basis, and begin to praise God for all that He has done. As 1 John chapter 4:18 tells us, perfect love casts out all fear. So as you abide in the perfect love of God, and all these worries come at you. Lord, how am I going to pay this bill? How am I going to pay that bill? What am I going to do? And I'm at the end of my rope. You can do more than just cope. You can discover His love that will cast out all the fear of the future, because He's taking care. And you can look back over your past and see how He's provided for you then, and He's going to continue to provide for you now. Take a look, as I mentioned earlier, at the Psalms. Read the Psalms. Let them become a part of your life. As I mentioned, the strength that David found, and he just expresses through the Psalm. And in Psalm 91, verses 2 and 3, says, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, I will trust. Surely He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He's going to deliver you from this perilous pestilence if you continue to do more than just hang on, but trust Him and let His power work within you. And watch how He'll do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Wow, we know we can rely on the love of God. We can know that He is there. We don't have to let fear and worry and unbelief just drive us down. Look around again. Lift up your eyes unto the Lord. See all the beauty of His creation, and continue to praise Him for what He's doing at this particular hour. 1 John chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in him. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. God definition. Who is God? God is love. Now think about it. It doesn't say just that God has love or God expresses love. God is love. Wow. And now He wants to let that love come and dwell within us so much that, as we read in John 3:16, that God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. What love the Father has for us at this particular time. And it's so important that if we say that we love God, God who we cannot see, and yet don't love our brothers and sisters whom we can see, how can we say that the love of God abides within us? So when we see so many more people hurting as a result of the coronavirus or COVID-19, and we see so many people that are in need and people at the end of their rope, if we become totally indifferent to their plight, how can we say the love of God abides in us? So we need to let His love come and dwell within us. And that's why we read this in 1 John chapter 4, verses 19 through 21. We love because He first loved us. There's the basis of our love. We love because He first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he's a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he cannot see, had not seen. And He has given us this commandment, whoever loves God must also love his brother and his sisters. So there we have it before us. We must let love focus in us and through us and flow through us. Flow through us. So regardless of what COVID-19 brings, God is still there, and God is love, and He wants to let His love flow through us, and He wants us to love others that are in need. And if we love only those who we can see and not the God who we can't see and don't love those who we can see, can we say the love of God really abides within us? So we need to really get with it and get into His Word. We have to let it flow in us and through us. And He goes on and says in 1 John 4:7-10, dear friends, let us love one another. For love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Talk about love. Thank you, Lord God, for your love. Thank you, Lord God, that I not only read about it in the Bible, but I can experience it as I move into the wonders of your creation. What a mighty God we serve. So don't just sit there, surrounded by the four walls that are pressing in upon you, feeling like that you're at the end of your rope and you can no longer cope. Turn yourself, let yourself be turned loose and to the love of God. Let's continue to take a look here at the Word of God. Romans 8, 35 through 39. I want to read this to you from the Message Bible because what it says is just so powerful in what it says. Do not think anyone is going to be able to drive a wedge between us and Christ's love for us. There's no way, no trouble, not hard times, not hatred, not hunger, not homelessness, not bullying threats, not backstabbing, not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. They kill us in cold blood because they hate you. We're sitting ducks. They pick us off one by one. None of this faces us because Jesus loves us. I'm absolutely convinced that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. Oh, man, that's mind-blowing. If that doesn't light your fire, your wood's wet. You need to get in the Word of God and see what it's got to say there. And it tells us that we are alive. We love because He first loved us. And nothing can separate us from that love, neither height nor depth nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come. Nothing in all of creation can separate us from the love of God. It just makes me want to say, praise the Lord, and stop and think, God, why do I worry so much? Why do I worry about this, that, or the other, when you promise that you'll never leave me nor forsake me? Why do I worry, Lord, as I move into the midst of the wonders of your creation and see, Lord, I don't need to sit here and worry, is the tide going to go in, tide going to go out? Is sun going to come up? Moon going to be there? It affects the tides? I mean, all this stuff. No. I don't have to worry. And Jesus gone on and said, look, learn from the birds. If your Heavenly Father takes care of them, won't He much more so take care of you? If He takes care of the flowers of the field, won't He take care of you? Oh, you of little faith. So stop worrying and realize that you don't have to just cope at the end of your rope. You can be more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens you. So at this moment, just relax in His love. Relax in His peace. Relax in His power that passes all understanding at this time. And don't worry about tomorrow. If you stop worrying about tomorrow, perhaps you won't feel like you're spending so much of life at the end of your rope where you can no longer cope. Instead, turn all those worries over to Jesus and watch Him do that mighty work in your life. So why do we worry so much about tomorrow? That worry constantly makes us feel like we're at the end of our rope, we can no longer cope. God is right there. He's given us all of His creation to remind us to live in the now. He's given us His Word. And faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And yet we continue to worry, worry, and worry some more. And no wonder we feel like we're at the end of our rope. And COVID-19 can give us so much to worry about. You hear it on the news. You hear the number of deaths, number of hospitalizations, number of people testing positive, what's happening with the economy, what's happening. Oh, man, you just get worn out talking about it all. So let's get back into God's Word here. Let's let the Word not only get in our head where we know it up here, but let these trials, tribulations, and tests move it from the head to the heart, where we can be more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. For it's the love of God which heals us of this toxic stress. It's the love of God that sets us free at this time and gives us the ability to love others, even those who aren't very lovable, that might come into our life. Wow, how can we love the unlovable people? By realizing that because Christ loved us first, and His love is working in us, He'll give us the strength to just really move forward in a way that we never thought was possible. I started out my day pretty early yesterday morning at 4:30, getting up, 5 o'clock, leaving work in New Bloomfield, driving to Springfield, working in Springfield among the homeless, the hurting there. And then when I drove back in the afternoon, just a driving rainstorm. This came from every different direction. In the midst of it all, I had an unusual peace of it. I was just driving along and didn't feel that worry about, oh, wow, what if I, go skid here? This happens, that happens. In fact, at one point, I had to stop for 45 minutes to an hour because they had to clear an accident off of Highway 44. But in the midst of it all, I felt the peace of God. Now, it hasn't always been that way. There's times that I've taken through storms that the whole thing is just one great big stressful mess. But when I got back, I knew I'd made it. And with at peace in my heart because of the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and meditating on that love enables us in the midst of whatever the storm of life may be to know that we're more than a conqueror through Christ to strengthen us. So we need to get into God's Word. We need to immerse ourselves in His Word. We need to let the light and love of Christ flow through us and discover that we are indeed more than conquerors through Christ to strengthen us. Remember, God just doesn't have love. God just doesn't give love. God is love. He's the source of all when you get plugged in Him. So many people are struggling at this time in need. And yet we're told in the Word that we can be more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And as Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30 says, that remember, a heart of peace gives life to the body. So we want to experience that heart of peace. Peace. And Isaiah tells us this. He says, those that hope in the Lord, he tells us in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, that those who hope in the Lord renew their strength. They're going to mount up like wings like an eagle, or some translations, soar like eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. So we can soar like eagles. Soar like eagles, even as we're traveling through the storms of life. We can and walk and not faint. The Lord God is good. And now maybe you're having to wait on Him. The Bible also says, those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. Yes, so we wait. If you're like me, I'm hating the waiting often. But I know that waiting, I can experience the peace of God that passes all understanding. So life is more than just holding on at the end of our rope, feeling we're just dangling there. Life is more than just coping as we feel like we're slipping. No, it's being more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens us. And Jesus invites us into that whole realm of thinking like that. He invites us to come and know His Father. He invites us to come experience His peace. He invites us to stop worrying all the time and start relaxing in His love, His mercy, His grace, and just experience what He's desiring to say to us at this time. I'd like to conclude with this thought. Philippians 4, take a look at it. Verses 6 through 9. Do not be anxious about anything, but every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things, and whatever you have learned or received from us or heard from me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. And Father God, I'm asking you right now to grant your peace that passes all understanding to my brother, to my sister. Help them, Lord, to know that they don't just have to feel like they're hanging at the end of the rope and just coping, but they can experience your peace even in the midst of the coronavirus. They can experience your peace that passes all understanding. They can experience your love, Lord God. For truly, because of your love, Almighty God, demonstrate through Christ Jesus, we are more than conquerors, and in this we rejoice. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.